Welcome back, everybody. We're at SPX 2015. I'm Rusty.
I'm Joe.
And this is...
Ben Toll.
Ben, hello.
Hello, Ben. How's it going?
It's going fantastic, man. It's great SPX as usual.
How many SPXs have you been to?
My memory's a little foggy, but I believe my first one was 1999 or 2000.
That's nice. Really early.
Yeah,
that's
obviously 2001 was canceled, and yes. I missed one for a wedding. But I think other than that, I've been to them all since then.
That's amazing.
That's solid.
Not too many people can say that.
No.
There are a few old-timers still kicking around. I came up with Rob Ullman from Richmond, and he'd been to the one that was back in Silver Spring. So he kind of...
Yeah.
That was before my time, but I definitely went to a lot of them down at the other...
I think you've earned your place. It's okay.
Yeah.
You know, you may not have been to all of them or the Silver Spring
Maybe
one.
Maybe not
yes,
Silver Spring.
But I'm an old-timer.
It's all right.
Ben, what brings you to SPX this year?
I got a new book. Yeah, I got Oyster War from Oni Press. Last few years, I've been working on it, so I've actually been coming to SPX just as a, you know, just to wander around and see the programming and stuff. But I'm back behind a table this year, so... Or I was back behind a table until about 5 minutes ago because I sold out of my books.
Nice.
So now I get to wander around for a little
that
bit.
That is
for
not
the last
a bad
hour.
Problem to have.
Yes.
No. I sold this. This is the copy that I was letting everybody paw through, and like I'd spilled some wine on the corner of it, and some guy came up. He said he wanted it. I gave him to for $10. So now I literally do not have a copy of my own book.
Wow. The demand is outrageous.
It's crazy, but it's cool. I'm not complaining. It's awesome.
When did the book come out?
It's debuting at SPX.
Wow.
So it's a debut. It will be, it's not in comic shops for another 3 weeks or so.
Oh, okay.
Wow. So
the people that have, obviously they're buying it, they're excited for it. It seems like there's not much feedback to go off of yet, probably.
No, but people flip, clearly they like something because they're flipping through it and buying it.
So, yeah, true.
But.
So from what I've seen before, you've done mostly like black and white work. Is that right?
Usually black and white with one color added, like
okay,
a grayscale or a blue or something. But yeah, that's my first full color thing. I was doing it as a webcomic, and you know, the nice thing about webcomics is color is free.
Yes.
But unlike printing where it costs
all
you
it
extra
costs
money.
All it costs you is file size.
Yeah, file size and just a lot of time.
And the paper people are like, we got to charge you a little bit more.
Yeah, exactly.
So how long have you been working on this?
So long I should probably not admit it.
Do you want to keep that mum?
5 years or so I was doing it.
It's a big book.
For a big book,
it
yeah.
It is, and I did it and colored it myself, and I do have a real job also, so there's that. But I started thinking about it probably 6 years ago, started scripting and started drawing maybe 5 years ago. I did a page every 2 weeks online until I got it pretty much done.
Wow.
So. Nice.
That's great.
So how did you hook up with the guys at Oni?
I've just known them, you know, it's just from being at cons, networking kids, just from being at various conventions and stuff, you know, you meet people, and I knew James, who was one of the editors, the big head editor at Oni, and I knew he liked my work, so I was looking for somebody. They've been putting out some nice big, you know, big hardcover European size things, like Costume Quest is one that came out mm-hmm. recently, and I was like, well, you know, they know what they're doing when it comes to that, and so I just emailed him, and we got to talking, you know, it was nice. First place I really approached when the book was about to be done, and they wanted it. So,
has it been easy to work with them on putting the book out?
Yeah, absolutely. They're great to work with. Zero static. We've agreed on everything. I think they did a fantastic job with the book. It's the first, really the first book I think that I've had published where like the book looks exactly like I imagined it in my head.
Wow, really?
So, yeah, I just could not be happier.
Well, it's so big.
Yeah, and they have like such good production value.
And that's
with these Oni hardcovers.
They're just such nice objects on top of being good books.
Yeah, and you need that today. It's like it's you got to give somebody a reason to not just buy it digitally. So you want you want the book to be a big physical object that makes it worth their while to actually buy it.
And especially when you were doing it as a webcomic anyway, because it was free.
Yeah, exactly. You could read it for free, so and be done with it. If you put out kind of a cruddy book, the people would probably just be content to have read it online and
right,
be on
exactly.
their way.
So you have to act like it's a different book. No, it's not the cruddy one.
Yeah, no.
No. It's Why do you think
edition.
It took so long? I did everything twice.
This bonus content.
Yeah, non-cruddy content. So do you have anything else that you're working on? I know this is brand new. And it's a terrible question to ask when it's just coming out.
I got a couple of things kind of in the works. I'll sit down and commit myself to another long-form book here maybe. Before the end of the year. And I've done a few odd things. I did some anthology contributions for Cartosia Tales. They've got a booth back there. I did an 8-pager for Creepy, which is a little odd,
wow,
but
really?
It was very
wow.
fun. Yeah, it's Dark Horse is doing that. I did that with the writers, Alex DeCampi. She writes a lot of stuff.
It's interesting that they've brought that back, and they're getting a lot of like indie artists and creators to work on this.
Yeah, they are, and I think they've been pretty successful at it. The issue I'm in is 22, and so I think the next one is in production. So they're you know a couple years into it, and they seem to be doing pretty well with it. You know.
So, one of the things about anthologies is it allows you to keep your name out there, keep your work out there.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
It gives you a variety of things to work on in between larger projects such mm-hmm. as this.
Yeah, and I use it kind of as a testing ground sometimes to, like, if I'm trying to learn a new skill, you know, I'll take, like, an 8-pager. Like, I'm kind of slowly transitioning to working digitally, so both with my Cartosia story and for Creepy, I thought that was a way for me to really test, learn, you know, a manga studio and learn working purely digital and trying to get it to look match my kind of naturalistic style. So I feel like now if I go into a long form book and I decide I want to do it digitally, it's going to look like me, you know.
And you also, you don't want your growth in this medium to change as the book goes on. Like your early work visually is going to look different than the later work.
Yeah, I did have to do it. I mean, this is 167 pages. And so one thing I did between the webcomic and Oni's publishing it was go back and fix a lot of stuff. You get that like character design drift, you know, where the character looks one way at the beginning and kind of slowly
and
morphs into
something else.
And so
well,
I went
like the telephone game. It just, you know, you don't notice it as it goes.
Exactly. You know, if you're drawing it page by page every couple of weeks, you don't notice it. But then when you go back and look through the book, you're like, gosh, that guy's changed a lot. So I did go back and, you know, redraw a lot of heads I redrew and that kind of stuff.
Right.
So hopefully it fits together as a cohesive whole a little more now than, you know, with those parts ironed out a little bit.
So did you do traditional art for the line art for this? Did you do digital coloring or?
Yeah, traditional line art, just, you know, dip pen on giant sheets of Bristol board and then digitally colored in Photoshop. So, yeah.
Now, you say you came to SPX for a few years without exhibiting. What was it about you that brought you back to the show during those years?
Oh, you know, I mean, part of it is just that there's, you know, there's people who come here to this show every year and it's the only time I ever see them, you know, because they're from all over the country. So there is that kind of aspect of just seeing friends that you only see at SPX. And then also, you know, it's like, you know, when you're behind a table, you don't get to really take in all the, you know, you don't get to see everybody. You don't get to slowly go through the floor and look what everybody has. Mm-hmm. And you don't get to I don't go to any programming, and I love the programming here. So, like, the last couple of years, I was able to go and see stuff, you know, without thinking, like, you know, I'm leaving my table.
You're missing sales.
Yeah,
you're
like missing sales.
Customers.
Yeah, so, I mean, it was really nice. And that's probably a pattern I'll do in the future, you know. If I have a new book to sell, I'll try to table, and if I don't, then I'll just come up for Saturday and you know, be a regular guy, you know, which is a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah.
It probably helps to keep you a part of the community, keep you motivated, because comics can be so isolating. You're on your own.
Yeah. We don't have, like, a, you know, I guess a lot of other professions have sort of a professional gathering, you know.
Sure.
That's, and like, this is that.
Much
yeah,
that.
This kind of serves as that, you know. You see what's, you know, what... you know, the kind of new people coming up are doing, you know, what's trends and styles are always changing. And, you know, you got to keep on top of that. I do a little teaching comics too. So it's, you know, I feel like I do my job better teaching if I know what's going on, you know, like if I know who's coming up, I know what's happening, you know, like what are the new artists, what kind of things stylistically are going on that I should be aware of. And just meeting new people, you know, it's like I order a lot of mini comics just through the mail, and it's, you know, a lot of those people show up here and it's
sure.
fun to meet them. And, you know, you get people you start to follow, you know, and you show up every year to see what new stuff they have.
Well, it's an easy way to find new things.
That, too.
There's just
absolutely.
So much stuff.
Yeah. And you're not going to get that by just, like, randomly clicking through people's websites, you know.
No.
It's like to walk around, see it all on a table, just to be able to flip through it is great.
You can't really, like, browse online.
Yeah, you can't browse online, you know, because all this stuff is not in anyone. It's not on Amazon or iTunes or whatever.
Right.
It's on everybody's little own website.
And you have
website.
To go to these individual places.
Yes,
it's
exactly.
not like here where there's one table of this, one table of that.
Yeah, exactly.
So, Ben, would you be interested in answering a mystery question?
Sure, give me a mystery question.
All
what
right. It's a mystery how to open it. That's the trick.
They can be difficult. Nice.
Okay. You did it.
What will be your weapon of choice when the zombie apocalypse hits? Oh, man, that's a hard one. I'm not really down with the zombie lore.
Well, that's why it's your choice. It could be love.
You know, I grew up in the 80s. I probably have to go with the Throwing Star.
Throwing Star. Oh, like, yeah, yeah. Excellent
like
choice.
Ninjas were big back in the day. Oh, like, you know,
it's a weapon you can use from
like
afar.
G.I. Joe, you know, like, what was his name? Snake Eyes, like all that stuff. Yeah.
Snake Eyes, yeah.
Yeah, I go with the Throwing Star.
Oh, my. You can use it from afar. You know, you
exactly.
Can carry a bunch
and
of
you don't want to get close enough for them to, like, start eating you and stuff.
Or,
so
yeah,
you need
or just, you know.
You don't anything. Want a sword or even, like, a pike, really.
No, nothing.
No.
Nothing
if
have
they're
to,
that close.
Nothing where you're both you're touching it at the same time.
Exactly, exactly.
So I think that's an excellent answer.
Good answer. Thank you.
It's a non-traditional zombie weapon that more people should use for zombie fighting.
Oh, my God, yeah. I think, well, you know what? Maybe in Japan they do.
It's possible.
Maybe in Japanese zombie lore, they do.
We need to follow
they're like
one.
Baseball bats, yeah, axes. I mean, what are you doing?
Yeah, it's foolish.
I have to go research some manga on that one. There may be.
Yeah. Now, in addition to finding this book in local comic stores, online, in various online stores, since it's from Oni, it's available pretty much.
Yeah, it's Amazon anywhere. Or Oni or
wherever. Do you have a personal website that you like to plug?
Yeah, benzilla.com. You can find, you know, links to my Twitter and Tumblr and all that junk. That's kind of my home base.
Okay. So. Cool. Awesome. Well, thanks for sitting with us.
All right, thank you.
Appreciate it. Enjoy the rest of your show.
I will.
Not selling it.